Mr. Deshant Pushparaja is a Managing Director, Global Markets and Investment Banking, Capital Alliance Partners Limited. And then we have Dr. K. Thavalingam, is a retired Survey General of Sri Lanka. So let me invite Deshan to the forum here. Deshan, stage is yours.
Hi everyone. It's good to hear everybody's versions of the legal aspects of investing in Sri Lanka. So I want to spend a little bit of time to talk about the practical aspects of investing in Sri Lanka, especially specifically not. I make my living actually intermediating investments, either portfolio investments into Sri Lanka or capital investments to actually make foreign direct investments. So you would take a look at both. I think a lot of this was covered by Sri Lanka's portfolio investment laws are fairly straightforward. There is an account called the investment account. Anyone can open an account and make investments, and then all dividends and all, when you sell your shares, whether it be in a private company or a public company, you can take your money back through that same channel without any complications. And successive governments over the last 30 years have always kept to that, and I think that's something that investors coming from overseas can reasonably rely on, where that channel is fairly straightforward. To the extent where it was a little too lax at one point, and Sri Lanka was put on the grey list for money laundering because our regulations were not strict enough, and the central bank worked with most of the banks over the last 2 years to set that right. So we are now very much on the right path. But that's a fairly straightforward method to invest both in private companies and in public companies in any form of security. So that's the preferred methodology that most investors would use to invest not only in a small amount but large amounts if they're investing in companies. But when you come to more kind of foreign direct investments where you're looking to start a business in Sri Lanka, if you're looking for something more than just investing and waiting, if you're looking for what are the benefits that you get and what are the risks involved in actually starting a business. Anecdotally speaking, most investors have found comfort in the fact that Sri Lankan law is based on common law principles. So that's something that everyone takes comfort from because they understand the legal system. It's based to some extent on the British law, which a lot of investors understand. So that's something that's always been some level of comfort for most of them. So they cover their contracts on that basis. Enforcement of law here in Sri Lanka has been a challenge, mostly around timing. It'll take you years to win anything in the courts here in Sri Lanka. So it's been largely, get the contract signed here and then maybe have arbitration in Singapore, which has generally been the principles that most large investors have looked for. But when you look specifically at the Northern Province, I think one thing you need to watch for is really the budget, because the annual budgets every year roll out different plans for tax incentives and incentive plans for those who are investing in particular identified areas that the governments have identified as priority areas for investment. So each year this changes. Unfortunately, we don't have budgets and incentives that stay in place for extended periods of time. So each time there is a budget, it's important to watch out for what's available. But generally speaking, the North has been identified as a priority area for investment. And so at certain points, there have been tax incentives to invest in the North. But beyond just looking at the incentives, I think you also need to look at what is it that would incentivize an investor to invest in the North. See, Sri Lanka is a small country. It's a population of 20 million. And so there is always a limitation to how fast you can grow. So, you know, investment in Sri Lanka has to be looked at as a means to an end rather than the end in itself. So most investors who have invested here, who started up factories, who started up companies here in Sri Lanka, have looked at it as a you know, springboard to enter into markets which Sri Lanka has very good trading relationships with. So India is one specific example, because the north of Sri Lanka is closer to South India than most of North India is, or even Central India is. And that opens up a lot of avenues and a lot of opportunity for trade. And, you know, that's what's always been one big part of, a big chunk of what Sri Lanka's economy has been, you know, dating back to 2,000, 3,000 years, is to be the conduit to enter into India. And we have a free trade agreement with India, which on paper looks good, but on the Indian side, the enforcement of it, the implementation of it has been poor. There was a proposal to broaden and deepen the free trade agreement with India, which the professionals, most of the professionals were against, because there is always this fear that Indian professionals are going to come into Sri Lanka and you know, take away our jobs. So that was put on the back burner. But to be frank, in some form, a deeper free trade agreement with India is something to really watch for, because that would really provide an incentive, especially to invest in the north, given its proximity and given that a new airport has been opened. Also, the other you know, factor that really allows a lot of investors to go through Sri Lanka is also the duty-free agreement, the GSP plus agreement that we have with the European Union. We are one of the few countries in this part of the world which has it, and that allows for a lot of products to flow into the European Union tax-free. So while you look at the legal aspects of investing in Sri Lanka, I think the free trade agreements and duty-free agreements that the country has with some of our neighbors and some of the other leading countries, I think, is also an important aspect to look at, because that is really the attraction for Sri Lanka. As I said earlier, with a 20 million population, there is the limitation to how fast you can grow. But it is about using some of these attractive, potentially attractive agreements that we could have with some very large economies that will probably be there.